Anyone sitting here?
There was, but there doesn't seem to be any at the moment.
There you go.
I think that's open now.
It's open now? Okay.
Yeah, I can come back here in the middle. That I know of. I thought your mom and dad were all sitting here. They're all standing up in front of us.
Yes.
You see it?
Yes.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. I'll stand by in the podium just so we can see what Dr. Kamideh's perspective will be today. How many people are really tired today? Put up your hand. I'm looking around the room. See, how many people were up until 2 or 3 in the morning? How many people were up until midnight? How many people were up until 2? How many people were up until 4? Dr. Kamideh, did you sleep?
4.
James,
5. The mic isn't on and not everybody can hear you.
Oh, not everybody can hear me?
That's
really?
Right.
That's never been, that's never happened before.
Check 1, 2.
Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
All right. I'm thrilled that you all came out this fine day after sleeping in on a Saturday morning. My name is James Pugsley. I'm the president of Astronomy North, and I'm honored to be here today to introduce everyone here to a very honored guest for Yellowknife. And before we begin, I'd like to thank a few people for making this all possible. First, we want to thank Aurora Village and Hideo Nagatani. Where are you, Hideo?
Here.
There he is. Everybody, a round of applause for Hideo. Hideo is the operator for Aurora Village, which is the world's most successful Aurora tour company. But we also have many Aurora tour companies in this room right now, and I want to acknowledge all of them as well, because last night would be an example of the quality of the tourism product that we have in the Northwest Territories. As well, when you meet our operators, you'll see it doesn't matter where you're from in the world, we have the best Aurora operators in the world. So big round of applause for all the Aurora operators. So my job today is, as the president of Astronomy North, is to help us all get through our Aurora hangover by introducing a champion of the Northern Lights, and in particular, the science of the Northern Lights. If you're not familiar, I'm not done thanking people. Actually, I want to thank the Northern Frontier Visitors Association as well for helping to make this all happen. Let's give a big round of applause. Thank you. Tracy and all of the board members, we want to definitely thank you for making this possible. And this is another example as to how science and outreach and tourism can all work together and how we can all learn more together with some of the great minds of science. And that is an excellent segue to talk about Dr. Kamideh. I met Dr. Kamideh a few years ago, actually just in advance of a presentation just like this. And I had heard of Dr. Kamideh for many years because of the work that I was doing. I had some strong connections to the Aurora tourism industry, and I was learning a lot about the Aurora over the past 10 years. And this one name kept coming up, Dr. Yosuke Kamideh. And I kept wondering, well, I need to meet this gentleman. You know, I have so many questions myself about the Aurora. And, you know, at the time that I came to Yellowknife, there weren't Aurora experts. We're all Aurora experts after last night. We're all going to be Aurora experts after this talk. But when I got here, I was really hoping to speak to some scientists about what's going on in the sky above. I kept hearing this name, Dr. Yosuke Kamideh. And what I was learning was that Dr. Kamideh's name, even though Dr. Kamideh wasn't in Yellowknife, Dr. Kamideh's name was very important to Yellowknife. And because of Dr. Kamideh, today, all of you, all that I do, all that Astronomy North does, everything that we see around us in the Aurora tourism sector is a result of some of the great work Dr. Kamideh has been doing. So I want to give you the official introduction to Dr. Kamideh. Dr. Kamideh has been one of the world's foremost Aurora experts for the past 30 years. In Japan, Dr. Kamideh served as the director of the Solar Terrestrial Environment Laboratory, STEL, at Nagoya University in Japan, which is the leading institution for auroral research, auroral studies. Internationally, Dr. Kamideh is recognized for his contribution to research at the Geophysical Institute at University of Alaska in Fairbanks, Alaska, and at the NOAA, which is National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration Space Environment Laboratory, presently known as the Space Weather Prediction Center, National Center for Atmospheric Research, and NOAA National Geophysical Data Center, which is located in Colorado. He was also a visiting scientist at the University of Alberta, John Hopkins University, University of Tromsø in Norway, the NASA Space Flight Center, UCLA, among others. Dr. Kamideh has received a number of medals and awards, including the Price Medal from the Royal Astronomical Society, the Axford Medal from Asia Oceania Geophysica Society. Did I get that right? Yes, sir. And the highest medals from scientific societies across Japan. Dr. Kamideh was also elected as Fellow of American Geophysical Union and the Royal Astronomical Society. He has published over 400 scientific papers. And as the author of numerous books and guidebooks introducing Aurora to the general public, Dr. Kamideh has established a foundation of knowledge in Japan that has substantially contributed to the success of Aurora tourism worldwide. And this is where it comes back to Yellowknife, is that the commitment that Dr. Kamideh has made to education and outreach over his career has made Aurora an everyday word in Japan, and has established Dr. Kamideh as a founding father of Aurora tourism, which has attracted thousands of visitors to Yellowknife and contributed millions of dollars annually to the economy of Yellowknife and the Northwest Territories over 20 years. There are very few opportunities that we get to really thank someone for that kind of contribution. He's basically honoring us today by being here, and we want to honor him as much as we can. And without further ado, please welcome Dr. Yosuke Kamideh. And Dr. Kamideh, we'd also like to thank you for last night's Aurora.
Sorry about two nights ago, but beautiful auroras, but lots of clouds so that we couldn't see it. Yeah, thank you very much. Very nice. Too much, I think, introduction. Today, I'd like to talk about this. Why do many Japanese people come all the way to Yellowknife almost every day? Okay. First of all, let's see. Many people think that I'm doing aurora physics. That's only partially true. I have been doing this kind of research topics, solar terrestrial physics. This is a big area. In easy terminology, this is relationship between the sun and the earth. We are living here on the earth's surface. Without sun, we cannot survive here. So this is a big subject. And space weather, this is becoming very important. And of course, this includes auroras. If aurora becomes very intense, like two nights ago, unfortunately, nobody has...
Elijah.
You have to understand me that I'm very, very tired. I came here three nights ago through Chicago and Calgary. And at each point, I had to spend 7 hours in the lounge and almost missed this connection, last connection flight. And then suddenly aurora became active 3 nights ago, very beautiful. And 2 nights ago, aurora was very active, maybe number one this year, but nobody was able to see it. But I was able to see it. I have a special technique to see it, almost all night. And then yesterday, as you know, beautiful aurora until 3 o'clock. So average sleeping time was only 2 hours. Where are we now? Yeah, space weather. I think many people have heard of this terminology, space weather. And one example is aurora, of course. But aurora is nice to see. But under space weather, there are many things that's not good to us. For example, sometimes airlines having a problem and making emergency landing. In terms of United Airlines, I have a record only from United Airlines. Japan Airlines are hiding all the important information. United Airlines gave me data. In 1 year, on average, they are making rerouting or emergency landing 53 times a year. Especially for the long flight, like New York, Washington DC, Chicago to Tokyo or Hong Kong or Delhi, that area. There are 4 routes in the polar route, and each day before departing, they decide which one they will take. Captain decide actually, but after airplane has left, something happened in the sun, and the high energy particle comes, then they have to reroute from switching from route 1 to route 4, for example. Even there is no route 5, so in that case, they have to make emergency landing in Anchorage or sometimes Sapporo in Hokkaido. And they have to put all those 500 passengers to hotels and becoming very expensive. But anyway, everything is caused by the sun. And also, we sometimes lose expensive satellite in space because of the sun eruption. So including everything, all bad things, even sometimes influencing your health. Plus aurora, which is nice. We call the entire thing the space weather. And auroras and geomagnetic storms. And 2 nights ago, actually, geomagnetic storm started. And I'll go into detail about magnetic storm later. Magnetospheric physics and substorms. Have you heard of substorms? How about breakup? That's interesting. All Japanese tourists know the auroral breakups. Breakup is a scientific terminology to indicate that suddenly aurora becomes active, as if light is coming from one point in the sky and spreading. So you feel like you are having a shower of aurora. But I'm not making this intentionally. Okay, this is the aurora of last night at Aurora Village. And within a few minutes, this aurora became like this. And yesterday's aurora was very easy for me to make a prediction. So all the customers enjoyed very much. And first arriving there at Aurora Village, I said within 15 minutes, aurora breakup comes. And not many people believed me. Then actually, within 15 minutes, plus minus maybe 1 minute, big suddenly this aurora broken up. Then people tend to becoming, believe me, yesterday about 6 or 7 breakups occurred. Simply because yesterday's event was, this is very professional, Hiruka, high intensity, long duration, and continuous auroral activity. This is too difficult, but yesterday, high speed solar wind. How about solar wind? Everybody knows solar wind? Yeah, kind of wind coming from the sun. And what is flowing? That is the sun itself, sun's atmosphere. Because sun's temperature is so high that gravity of the sun cannot hold it anymore, so that this solar atmosphere is distributing to almost everywhere. And only part of that comes to the Earth. Because the sun always neglects Earth. If you compare that the size of the sun and the size of the Earth, then you can understand that what's the relationship between those. Suppose you are, each of you are the sun, then Earth is 30 meters away from you and only 2 millimeters, like this. So the sun automatically always neglects us. But unfortunately, we are on this 2 millimeter sphere and looking at the sun. And yesterday was high intensity, long duration, and continuous solar wind was blowing. So that's why, and that has also plus and minus, plus and minus, plus and minus, very periodic magnetic field inside that flow. That's why very easy. I can show you this example. Too small, but look at only the upper part. White line is the intensity of the solar wind, which is stealing from the sun. And this one, this solar wind departed 3 days ago. And can you see arrow? Yeah. And yesterday, as I said, it was high speed. How high? That was 600 kilometers per second. But it took 3 days from the sun to the Earth. But usually 300 or 400. So you can see this. One day before yesterday, it was only, let's see, 400 kilometers per second. But this is still high, right? Shinkansen speed, bullet train. But Japanese kids once said that during my talk, 400. Oh, that's same as the Shinkansen speed. That's not correct. This is per second. And bullet train is 400 per hour. But so that's good example to show that this is really high, but takes 3 days. So this solar wind departed the sun 3 days ago, and finally reaching yesterday into to the Earth. And increase, before that I have to finish. This is 24 hours, and those numbers are time at London or Greenwich time, universal time. Because this is professional data, there is no explanation for in the easy terminology, sorry about this, but we are using this. Many people, 100 people in the world are using this data. And this is real time, available in real time. So this is 24 hours, so that means last point is present time, real time, minus 5 seconds. Why minus second? Because this from this satellite takes 5 seconds by light speed. But anyway, you can see this white one, a magnetic field 2 nights ago, very high, almost reaching 20. Again, this is a unit, professional unit, nano Tesla. I'm losing this arrow, oh yeah. 20 nano Tesla. And 1 day before that, only 5 nano Tesla. And usually 5 nano Tesla, that kind of average value. But so yesterday, two days ago, it was very high. And you can see this now red line. If red line goes down like this, that means I can predict definitely with 100% confidence that aurora becomes very, very active. And actually, it so happened 2 nights ago, although nobody was able to see it. And when I said some of the customers there at Aurora Beach, nobody was believing me because no aurora there up there. But this aurora was number one this year. That's why I couldn't sleep that night. I was so frustrated. Then yesterday, behind this big plasma cloud or solar wind, you can see, you know, almost periodic, this plasma having periodic magnetic field, becoming minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, small scale structures. That was in charge of the aurora last night. And the aurora becoming bright and faint, become bright and faint, exactly following this wavy structures. That's why, again, very easy to make predictions yesterday. And this one continues even to today, as far as 2 hours ago, I checked this data. So this one is today's. Okay, what time in London now, universal time? 21 is the last point here. And what I showed was this area, I guess. So this is what the present situation. If weather is fine, you can see auroras like last night, beautiful auroras, every 30 minutes or every 40 minutes, brightening and becoming faint. But if you look at this yellow curve, solar wind speed is slowly decreasing. Presently, how much? About 500 kilometers per second, still higher than the average value. Oops. Okay, this is the magnetic field changes in Yellowknife. If aurora is bright, that means conductivity is high. I hope many people are familiar with this conductivity, how easy that electric current flows. So aurora is bright, that means that area current is very high. If current is high, then the magnetic field produced by the current becomes also high. And that is what this magnetic field is observed. And this is, again, universal time. And this is 6. This is all, everything, is, this entire graph is for 24 hours. Again, universal time, in London time. And 7 o'clock in London is midnight here in Yellowknife. So this is midnight. And look at only the top panel. Again, this is midnight. I think many people noticed that yesterday, aurora started even from evening. That is this one. So, and then entering this periodic area, and ending about 2 o'clock. This is midnight, 1 to 2 o'clock in the morning. But I had to be up until 6 o'clock, 5 or 6 o'clock, until next one may be coming, expecting that next one may be coming. So we call this entire period hill cart. This is very professional terminology. So, okay, this is a kind of introduction for yesterday's Aurora. Yeah, my name is Kamide, Yosuke Kamide, that is YK. If you YK, that is Yonai.
Oh, yeah.
That's why I cannot forget this city forever. And the purpose of this time, this visit, was having three purposes. One is, all those are to help Japanese, mostly Japanese, but some are English-speaking people there. Lectures on Aurora almost every day. And then prediction of Aurora. And this is, to me, the main purpose of my visit this year here. Because I'm retired already, I have 50 years of experience of Aurora research, so that maybe I'm one of the few who can predict Aurora breakup, or when the Aurora becomes intensified. So, and some can be documented in papers, but some are in my brain on this, and some are confidential, secret. But combining all those things together, I'm every day at the site, I'm doing this prediction. And this is fun, really fun to me, because people are fun if that my prediction is correct. And if I say within 63 minutes, Aurora becomes intensified and the breakup comes, then for that 60 minutes, people just enjoy drinking, relaxing. And then that time becomes approaching, then they just go out and look up sky. And if Aurora is coming exactly as I said, then they are happy. And they appreciate my effort. But I'm not too happy with that. If I fail in prediction, then I'm very happy. That's why I'm here. If I fail, that means that there are many, several or many problems still remain to be solved. And I'm old enough already so that I can leave those new questions to younger generations. That's why I'm happy if my prediction fails. Actually, that is the most important purpose of being here this time. And in any case, that my prediction is correct or incorrect, people are outside already at the time that when I specified this time Aurora will be intensified. And Aurora is actually intensified, then I have to explain that this form is like this, like this, like this. And the motion and colors even. So I came here this time with those three purposes. Many people ask me, and maybe you are wondering this. Why so many Japanese people, I don't know how many, but are coming to Yellowknife or other places, Aurora places. First, they love cold place, that's why people come. Maybe not. And they have too much money to travel. And they went to all over the place already, except for Yellowknife. That's why they come. Number three is correct. Yellowknife is the best place in the world to observe Aurora. not only to appreciate the beauty of aurora, but they try to find implication of life on this planet. I'll go into detail about this, what do you mean? They are not coming to make babies under the... I didn't know about that story. I was shocked to hear that. That's why I did not list that as number four. Okay, there are three elements to appreciate auroras: shape, motion, and color. And shape, maybe you knew already that basically in a large scale, aurora is sitting there in the north, east-west direction. This is true even if you go to Fairbanks, even if you go to Scandinavia. What does that mean? That means that you are seeing only part of the entire belt, aurora belt. So at each point, you can see the aurora in the east-west direction, large scale. This is only large scale. Small scale, that means, for example, under breakup, then all kinds of things. That's almost noise to me, and not only to me, noise to chaos, or noise to all the aurora physicists. It's very difficult to solve this. I don't think anybody is trying to understand this, all kinds of shapes, like yesterday's different shapes physically. Impossible to solve that. And the motion, this you may notice this. If you look at northern sky in the evening, just after sunset, and if that sun was active 3 days ago, then the aurora is sitting there in the north and slowly approaching you, moving to the south. That means this belt, aurora belt, in the global scale is expanding slowly, taking about 1 hour typically. Then going back to the north. And that process, during that transition from north-south motion to forward motion, that during that moment, auroral breakup occurs. This is a ground rule. And color, you can, most typical color, too, green and red. And very rare, but blue, purple, and pink. And yesterday we saw lots of pink color at the bottom of the curtain. And there are many, many unknown questions, unsolved questions, even though many people worked hard in the world. In Japan, auroral physicists, about 800. I don't know how many in Canada, and maybe 1,000 in the United States. And Japan is one of the leading countries in aurora. And many people wondering if, ask me, why there are 800 aurora physicists in Japan when you cannot see aurora in Japan. Then if that question comes from a Canadian colleague in geophysics, I ask him why Canada has 2,000 earthquake researchers, even if there is no earthquake in Canada. So we are not doing only aurora. We are doing, again, the relationship between sun and earth, using aurora as a tool. And in Canada, they are doing earthquake seismology to try to understand the inside of the earth. Anyway, there are many, 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 maybe I can list 100 more here. And about 10 years ago, I wrote, published a paper in which I stated that those questions may not be solved for 100 years to come. And very difficult, especially, yeah, all those are difficult, but particularly why do aurora move in that fashion? In that fashion is very difficult to describe. Curtain and moving like this, like this, like this. There is no way to express that equation by equation. And people thought that is because of wind. Wind is blowing this, but there is no wind there. That is already space, not Earth. And other questions? Oh, by the way, you can ask me any questions you like.
Can you make an aura? Can you make one? Can you make one? Man-able? Like, you make it one by yourself, by human beings, can you make one?
Aurora?
Yeah.
How? Actually, artificial auroras. There. Okay, Yellowknife is the best place in the world. I kept saying this over the last 20, 30 years. And for that, there are three solid reasons. One is, I think many people know that this latitude of this Yellowknife is 62.5. degrees, but that is geographically true, but geomagnetically it's 69 degrees. And the latitude where aurora breakup, I think I explained aurora breakup, occurred most often is 67 degrees. And the aurora, as I said, aurora moves after the breakup, moved forward. So suppose that aurora breakup occurs at 67 degrees, then the moving forward, then sitting 69 degrees is the best place. And Fairbanks, for example, is latitude is 64.7 degrees. What does that mean? 67 degrees is the best place for breakup to occur. The aurora moves forward. So Fairbanks is not very good. But always this is Fairbanks and the Yellowknife are competing with each other, at least in Japan, to attract people. And European cities are 67 or 60, between 64 and 67 degrees. So only in terms of latitude, this is one of the best places in the world. And the stable weather in the winter time, maybe except for this year, February. I hope that March weather is improving. And number three point, this is very important. And nobody, no scientists say that, but this is true. In Yellowknife here, not only Yellowknife, this area, magnetic field, geomagnetic field originating in the Earth, Earth is weak. Not very weak, but relatively weak compared to, for example, Europe. What does that mean? Magnetic field is weak. Aurora is created by collision processes between the particle from space and particle of the, on the Earth's surface collide each other. So this is a collaboration between space and Earth processes. And high energy particle comes from space and coming into the Earth's atmosphere. And if that energy is high, very high, then that comes deeper. If energy is lower, then that particle cannot come deeper into the atmosphere. So having intense aurora, you have to have weak magnetic field so that high energy particle or medium energy particle can enter deeper. So that's why weak magnetic field is important here. And where the aurora can be seen most often. This is, sorry about this, the Japanese. Can you see this small numbers here? This is one. One means along this line, people can see under this this line only once per year. And what's next one? Next line is five times a year, and 10, where are we now? 10, 30, 100, and above that, maximum. Oh, before that, before going here, this is 0.1 per year. That means only one times per 10 years. That's where we in Japan, Japanese people can see only once per 10 years. And maximum, this one, is going through Yellowknife and slightly north of Fairbanks. That's why, and this, oops. This year, that's why, this doesn't work. Yeah, I think the battery is gone. Okay, this area, people can see quite often the aurora. And the magnetic field is relatively low. That's why aurora becomes brighter compared to this European area. This is in more detail. Where is Yellowknife? This is Great Slave Lake. So this is Yellowknife. And this line in red is geomagnetic latitude, 70 degrees. So yellow and the black one is geographic latitude, only 62 degrees. So Yellowknife is a unique place where geographically latitude is low, but geomagnetically high. Again, this is good for seeing aurora. Very briefly, what is aurora? The Earth is magnetic field. Many people think that Earth has a big dipole-type magnet inside, but that's not the case. Earth, if you go inside of Earth, almost center of the Earth, then temperature is very high, like 5,000 degrees or 6,000 degrees. Then magnet, even if there is magnet, big magnet there, magnetic power is lost because of the high temperature. So we cannot have magnet inside, but there is magnetic field. So only the only way we can have a magnetic field is through dynamo. Electric current is flowing inside the Earth. But anyway, regardless of those two choices, one is magnet, the other one is electric current, and the electric current is real. Regardless of those two choices, we can have magnetic fields surrounding the Earth like this, symmetric. But if Sun is there, assuming that Sun is on the left-hand side, many people said that why Sun is on the left-hand side? Well, if you like that, you like to set Sun on the right-hand side, that's fine. Or in front of you, that side, fine. But That means that I can put the sun on the left-hand side for simplicity. And as I said, those particles coming, we call this plasma charged particles. This is again from the sun. Is this fixed?
Yes.
Thanks. Is flowing from the sun. This is what we call solar wind, and making this Earth's magnetic field lines asymmetric, like this, having tail like this. And how long is this tail? And this is the Earth, and our moon is located about 60 times Earth's radius, so somewhere over there, that is a moon. And this tail extending at least to the moon. And some research said that magnetotail, we call this magnetotail, goes to even Jupiter. And picking up Jupiter's high energy particle and making the aurora. And this is a tricky point. In the almost the center of the magnetotail, plasma particle or solar atmosphere is accumulating. And this process is unknown. Presently, I think in the world, about 200 people are writing thesis about this. How those particles, solar wind, this becomes, enters into this, how this is possible. But that process is not solved yet, but this is true that plasma particles coming or accumulated here in the center of the tail, on the day side, night side. This can solve if everything becomes clear. Then big question can be solved. When I was a elementary school kid, I had a big question, like when teacher said, aurora's source is the sun. So I asked him, the teacher, then why aurora is on the night side when the source of the aurora is on the day side? Then he said, never mind, or don't worry. Aurora exists even on the day side, but the day side is not dark, so that you cannot see it. But that's wrong answer. On the day side, we have special equipment to measure our electron density on the day side, even under daylight. And yes, aurora is there, but the aurora brightness on the day side is very, very weak compared to night side. But still, you have to explain how this solar wind particles can get into this tail. This is still puzzling. But anyway, those particles in the tail are observed, are being observed every day. Like this. And then if accumulated and too much, and the magnetotail cannot hold this amount anymore, then some of them get away to the Earth and colliding with the Earth's atmosphere, making aurora. And what particle collides with what particle makes different colors? If the solar wind is very strong, intense like last night, Can you, you can see the difference between this and this. This is a normal situation. But like last night, aurora, solar wind density is becoming high, then we have lots of particles. Let's see. Sorry about this. Like this. Then density in the tail also being accumulated becomes high also. And again, coming into the Earth, making another type of aurora in Japan, in low latitude. Okay, slightly changing subject. Can you see aurora here?
Yeah.
This was a series of pictures taken by Takasaka-san. Takasaka, where is it? Oh, here. Can I use this? Okay. Can anybody see, everybody see auroras? This is just after sunset. And within maybe 30 minutes, this becomes like this. And within 5 minutes, like this. Then another 5 minutes. This is auroral breakup. And this is, remember, this is only part of the sky. Breakup means that the whole sky becomes like this. Okay, next one. We made motion pictures last year, because I was here for 3 weeks last year. And making, this is only 30 second movie taken at Aurora Village. We are now seeing this south from Aurora Village. And so that those lights are from downtown of Yellowknife. Let's move this. Is there a battery the problem? Oops. No, I like to shift this one. Yes. Okay, now I can show you how the breakup begins and develops. So now, as I said, we are facing to the south. And those are downtown light down there. Okay, maybe. This is becomes, this is 3 times faster than reality. But now it's extending to the north, as I said, forward expansion. Yeah, that night people were able to see pink color.
Yeah. Can you see them actually, most of it with the naked eye though?
Yeah, that's a question that somebody can answer, maybe Shimyo-sensei can answer later. Yeah, I'll go into detail. One more time. Yeah, 2 nights ago, I saw about 5 people just crying seeing this breakup.
Mm-hmm.
Because you may not feel this, but those Japanese people, educated people, think that this light is a combination from space and Earth. And this motion and color and the shape are collaboration from space and Earth. And we are living under this. Okay, this is the aurora. This is not painting. This is a real picture of auroras in the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere. So taken by a satellite sitting at the equator. And if you take this kind of picture from above the pole, then like a belt. But this is from this side. And you can see that this bright point and less bright point, and again bright point. And this bright point in the northern hemisphere and this bright point in the southern hemisphere are connected by magnetic field lines. And the same thing is true for this bright area. This and this are connected. This is Australia, and Japan is somewhere there. And the Yellowknife is hiding. This is the illustration except for this part. This is again real picture taken by a satellite. And this is the sun, but this scale is not correct. Sun is 100 times bigger than the Earth. But since the Earth has a magnetic field, that has a kind of a barrier against high energy particles. Without this magnetic field, this high energy particle comes freely into this, even hitting your body, making you sick. Okay, quiz time. I have a few quiz. Can everybody see this? Is the number of colors of aurora more than that of a rainbow? No? That's true. But in Japan, for some reason, rainbow color is 7. How many in Canada?
7.
If you go to other countries, they say 14. Other people, other countries say 6. I think in the United States it's 6. But in Japan, 7, lucky number. Okay, this is the true story. Number of colored rainbow is infinity. That's top panel. So from blue or purple to the red, this is continuous. But aurora has only limited number of colors. And we identified already 200 colors. Although this showed only about 10 or so, but 200 identified. So number of colors of rainbow is much, much more. Okay, this is an interesting picture. This is what aurora breakup looks like from space. So if you are sitting there at the southern part of Greenland, that at this particular time, particular day, then you could see aurora breakup. And this satellite picture was available every 3 minutes. So that picture you just saw was this one. And 3 minutes after is this, 3 minutes after that, 3 minutes after that. So this area is expanding as aurora, we call substorm, expand. But how about 3 minutes before this? 3 minutes before this, is there any indication that this area is about to broken up? Nothing you can see. So aurora breakup actually start within 3 minutes. And if you solve this, how aurora breakup be created, then this becomes a big contribution to plasma instability. Basic questions could be solved. Even these days, more detailed data, every this time, 1 minute. Where is breakup? This little circle is the auroral belt. And the upper part is day side. And the night side, and the dawn and dusk for each. And time goes like this, and then like this, every 1 minute. So aurora breakup is somewhere here. And 1 minute before that, you can see some indication there. 2 minutes before that. But 3 minutes, nothing. 4 minutes, nothing. And there is no way to predict where in the sky of Yellowknife aurora breakup occurs. There, or there, or there. This is from space shuttle over Helsinki. And this is a city light, because this picture was taken by astronaut holding camera like this, of course made in Japan. And then space shuttle is moving very fast, about 8 kilometers per second. That's why this moving, this light is moving within exposure time, 5 seconds in this particular case. But now we have international space stations from which we can see almost movie things. This is a very beautiful aurora pictures taken from International Space Station last year. So I invite everybody to the International Space Station. From the window you can see auroras. Very beautiful. And this is in the southern hemisphere. See, stop here. And this, you can see this line. This is the direction of the magnetic field. If you trace this magnetic field, go like this, up, 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 but this never goes to infinity. This bending somewhere and go over the equator and coming into the northern hemisphere. So that that point in the northern hemisphere and this point in the southern hemisphere, you can see same type of aurora, same color of aurora, same motion of aurora we see. Okay. Now we are above New Zealand, and the right hand side is Antarctica. And this one, oops, is this blue light from the right-hand side is sunrise. And I'll show you one more from the northern hemisphere. This is from northern hemisphere. You can see many city lights, and I don't know how many you can identify, but starting Helsinki and ending in the Delhi. Okay, this is, I think, Helsinki area. But don't miss this aurora. This is the main subject. And this big city coming into this scope, this is Moscow. And many, many, many cities. As I said, ending in India. Okay, this is from one of the old satellites, but beautifully Japanese island can be seen. That's why I'm showing this. And this is aurora of Siberia, and Sapporo, and Tokyo, and Nagoya, Kyoto, and Kyushu, something like that. And this city, of course, North Korea is just black, this area, no electricity. And this is Japanese island, and when people saw this picture first, what is this question? This light, there is no city there. Maybe UFO was arriving there, or all kind of story were created. But turned out, this is from NOAA. And they identified this particular time or particular day, 4,000 of ships fishing squid were there. Okay, next question. I think I told you already the answer to this. How long does it take for the seed of aurora is a solar wind? Sun's atmosphere. Yeah, 3 days average. Yesterday, 2.5 days.
Excuse me?
Yes?
Why was last night there was no moon until the aurora was done?
The moon, appearance of moon or the disappearing of the moon has nothing to do with the aurora. And that yesterday's was like this. The moon appeared around what time? Around midnight?
About around 1 morning when it was done?
Yeah, that has nothing to do with aurora.
It seemed like, just for us, it seemed like at 2 o'clock in the morning, maybe a coincidence, but as soon as the aurora was finished, in our, from our point of view, our eyes, the moon came up very low and quite big to the right, so we were trying to understand if there was a link of them, but there is not.
No link. That's just coincidence.
Oh, okay.
Well, I asked them to do that.
Thanks for that.
Again, those two are independent process. What's this? I'm almost through ending this talk.
Dr. Kamita, you were talking about the squid coming all together. Are there studies done that human nature or animal nature is affected by the magnetic atmosphere?
That's a difficult question, but I didn't say that the squid comes together.
Oh, sorry.
People, squid boat came together.
Oh,
4,000 of them.
Okay.
Oh, this is the same as that. Let's stop this. Okay, how big, I said that the aurora is like the aurora belt, forming aurora belt. How big that aurora belt can be, maximum? And this is the maximum as far as I saw. This is a satellite picture, 2000, July 16th. This was during July 14th. Big magnetic storm. Anybody from France? July 14th is very important day.
Bastille Day,
yes. So we call this Bastille magnetic storm.
Just for the
yeah, that's maybe again coincidence. Okay, this day, aurora was very bright, maximum at Florida. And actually, we predicted that aurora can be seen in Japan. And Japan is here. So just by difference in several hours or so, we missed this auroras, but United States, those people swimming in the Florida beach, they are very surprised to see aurora there. Mm. So this is a kind of maximum aurora belt we could see. And this is actually the aurora coming.
That time, I took a flight from China to France.
I see.
That day there was a crash. There was a crash of the airplane Concorde.
Oh, that day.
Yeah, that day. Yeah, and so people were making some links between these events. Are there some events between the air crashes or accidents between aurora or this kind of storm, and also the...
I don't know. But if you say so, I was in the airplane that day from Japan to Europe by Lufthansa. That did not crash.
That was not a flight from France to New York.
Yeah, I know that event. Yeah. But anyway, when aurora is very intense and the magnetic field storm is intense, then a communication problem occurs. Communication between the ground and the airplane.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I was called about 10 years ago, April 2001, I guess. For about 30 minutes, airplane was missing. And communication just was disrupted. Because of aurora, yeah, that's often, quite often happens. Okay, anyway, this is the aurora in Hokkaido, Japan, northern part of Japan, and many people thought that this is just a sunset, but this was taken 20 minutes before midnight. So it cannot be. Then our next candidate was fire. So fire engine went to there, go to mountain, try to take. And this was last year, last January. Oops.
Doesn't move. So how is the aurora that we see in Yellowknife different than we see in other places, like you're mentioning Hokkaido and stuff?
But... Oh, okay. Just a few minutes ago, you saw the nice auroras taken from International Space Station, and if you are careful, you saw aurora in green, and above that, top of that, top part was red. And even you can, last night we could see that red, but bloody, not really red, but almost black and red, combination of that. And that black red area is seen horizontally from Hokkaido, from Japan. Then integration of this atmospheric width becomes larger compared to see this vertically, so that red becomes enhanced. That's why like this. Is that understandable? Okay, anyway, last year, January, we predicted aurora is coming to lower latitudes, including Japan. That was broadcasted and published in the newspaper. Then many people came to Hokkaido to see red aurora, but big snowstorm, and so nobody was able to see it. And next day, through internet, I was accused of that.
Dissident.
Yeah. So that's simply because of bad weather. But same day, a report came from Australia. This is from near Melbourne. Beautiful red aurora was taken, observed. And Melbourne and Hokkaido are connected by field line. And last year there were three chances, and this is one of them. And the second, I think people saw from aurora from London, and the third time people saw aurora from Arizona. Okay, this is a good news for you. if the sun becomes stronger, then aurora is coming down to low latitude, making this belt larger. If sun is larger, the sun is strong. But if magnetic field of the Earth becomes weak, that is equivalent to this sun is becoming stronger. And actually, the Earth's magnetic field is decreasing this power over the last 200 years. Nobody knows why, because nobody knows what causes the magnetic field of the Earth. But first point, 1830, was measured by Gauss. I think you have heard of the name of Gauss, German physicist. He is the first who measured the Earth's magnetic field strength. And that was this point, first point. Then since then, many people measured, and of course these days, satellite can measure this. And this intensity is decreasing monotonically over the last 200 years. If we extend this to this one, to the right-hand side, we are not supposed to do this as a scientist, because using only 200 years of data, extending to 1,000 years, we should not do that. But just for fun, we can do that. How fast this aurora belt becomes larger and larger, and coming to Japan. And this is the result of the calculation. This is in 1,000 years, aurora disappeared completely from Yellowknife. Sorry about that. And coming to Japan. When I said this to a publisher, publishing a general audience science magazine, then they did this kind of special issue.
Special issue.
Okay, last quiz. What do auroras at the equatorial region look like? Of course, aurora is a high latitude phenomena, but we can artificially generate aurora in the equatorial regions. And actually, Max Planck Institute, Germany, they did a big experiment generating artificial aurora in India. And the picture was like this. And many Indian people were very surprised because they are not notified about this. And calling the police, said UFO appeared. And at the equatorial region, magnetic field line direction is horizontal. At high latitude, vertical. That's why you see curtain-like auroras. But if you go to India, equatorial region, then the magnetic field line is horizontal. And how they make artificial aurora? I think some of you have experience of having barium cloud, barium in the stomach test. And carrying this only 100 grams of barium and the rocket launch and just release that in the upper atmosphere, then creating this. Why barium? I don't know the details, but the barium is emitting nice color like this. Pink color, and interaction time is perfect. And very quickly, this is, aurora is not only Earth. This, and this, Jupiter, and this is Jupiter, and this is, this is the final topics. Many people think that this year is the peak of solar maximum. And solar, this is a sunspot number from 1600. And one time this area was 75 years. Sunspot almost disappeared. And aurora disappeared. for this extending period of time. And the earth becomes very cold. We call this interval Maunda minimum time. I think some of you may have heard of this. And since then, the sun solar activity comes back, and the average 11 years, this sunspot numbers go up, down, up, down, up, down. But this peak, this is a peak, this is another peak, this is another peak. But intensity of the peak varies. This peak was very strong, strongest in the history. And this is the most recent five period. I showed this graph last year at this place. So last point of this diagram is 2012. Again, I lost this one. And how about this year? So pay attention to this area. Still growing, right? Last year. But this year, becoming like this. So this means that the maximum has already passed. But according to NASA's news release today, as of today, this one may be misleading, saying that another peak will appear, so double peaked. We don't know that yet. Okay, this is almost end. Why are people, not only Japanese people, but people interested in seeing aurora? Of course, number one is, yes, everybody agrees. Number two, Japanese people come to Yellowknife to see aurora, to understand the implication of the aurora and the sun and the earth. And this is the message from auroras. Auroras are generated, this is true, through complicated, really complicated processes, because we have not solved this yet, resulting from close and delicate interactions between the sun and the earth. Number two, the earth has aurora. This is the evidence that life like us can survive here in this solar terrestrial environment. In this room, there are two important things. One is air. Of course, if I take all the air out from this room, then what's happened to all of you? That's easy to guess. But number two is magnetic field. There are magnetic field lines passing through your body. Taking all those magnetic fields away, then what's happened? Many people think nothing happened. But if there is no magnetic field in this room, then high energy particles from space comes in. Then I don't know what happened, but many bad things can happen. Not almost instantly die, but eventually life will disappear from this planet. So we are living here because of those two things, and aurora is there because of those two things. So seeing aurora, we are learning our life. And number three is a kind of message. Only human being on this planet has become able to change this precious. That means having two basic elements, magnetic field and air, atmosphere. We can change this by doing, in some country, if somebody press the button, then explosion or nuclear test or something can be done. Then that can change the atmosphere constituent. Then changing aurora color color of aurora. That is a sign that everybody must die. If all the human beings disappeared from this earth, still the earth is rotating. They don't care about people living here or not. Okay, that's a kind of sad message, but we should not make that happen. Thank you very much. Somebody is chairing this session, or I have to do this. Taking questions.
First of all, how many people in the room now are Aurora experts? Hands up. You are all now Aurora experts. And Dr. Kamide is, given us so much knowledge today, but, the challenge now is, now that you're all experts, is you need to assist Dr. Kamide with his research. The way that you do it is with your camera. And so, every time you take a picture of the aurora, you are actually collecting data. And so tonight, get some rest, because I think it's going to be cloudy. Tomorrow night, I think it's supposed to clear up. And you're going to start to collect some more data. So I want you now all to think about you as the scientists now. Think about your data. Now ask your questions as the scientists to the scientist. Anybody have questions?
Is there any relationship around aurora and sound?
Sound? I couldn't get the question. Sound relationship between
The sound of the aurora.
Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah, many people can hear sound from aurora, and the next answer was they can hear the sound from aurora, and aurora is moving like this, like this, like this. Then what you can hear can move also and change like this, almost instantly. But as you know, the sound has a limited sound speed, not like light. So from this aurora altitude to your place takes at least 5 minutes. So that those people claim that the aurora moves, then the sound also changes, should not occur. And also, nobody was able to record aurora sound. But still, this is in Helsinki, in Technical University. They did a big experiment, like a blind test, using 1,000 students, and closing their eyes, and they can hear noise or sound, type of hiss noise, H-I-S-S, hiss noise, without seeing the aurora. And about 50% of people exactly could hear this noise, even without seeing aurora, when aurora is there. So if everything is true, then there is only one explanation. From the aurora to your ear, this speed is almost infinity, like light speed. Comes into your ear, then in this your complicated ear system, ear and brain, and changing the light speed into, electromagnetic wave into sound wave in your ear. Then everybody is happy, but nobody can prove this is true or not. But this is present knowledge, because many people can hear this. Especially young male is able to see, hear the sounds from aurora. Are you able to hear sound? And yesterday, dog was barking. Yeah, whenever that aurora becomes brighter.
I think that's because everybody rushes outside at the same time.
And actually, more precisely, dogs bark before aurora breakup occurs, few minutes before, almost always.
The question I asked before in terms of seeing it was your human eye, because I was out there and saw a lot of the white lights and beautiful moving and a little bit of, you know, that, but my camera isn't good enough, but when I looked at it through the viewer, I could see the green, but if I looked at it without it, I could not see it. So
yes. I
how much
I
can you actually
answer.
See with the human eye?
Mm-hmm. Okay, taking pictures of aurora, you need exposure time. So that means integrating, actually aurora is a whitish green. And the human being is able to distinguish or catch the aurora every, let's see, 1/20 seconds or something. In 1 second, we can see the change of colors 20 times per second. But taking picture, you need exposure time, 5 seconds or something, during which the integration occurs. That's why green color, whitish green becomes green, and get enhanced.
But you don't see the depth of the color. You don't through your eye. That's, I mean, like last night, I saw the color, but not the depth that you see when you have it on a picture.
Oh, I see. And also yesterday, I noticed that. There are 100 people watching the same aurora, and some people said, oh, that becomes pink. And this person said, no, I cannot see it. And so depending on the person also.
Depends how much TV you watch.
Yeah.
The best answer for that is that everybody has a different way of interpreting the color as they absorb that, as we absorb the light through our eyes. So the other interesting thing too is that cameras also record the sky differently, or the different shades of green and red. So, some talk about how even there are some noticeable differences between Nikon and Canon cameras. If you take this picture of the same aurora, you'll see one has more green in it and one has more red. And so, what is quite interesting too is when we see those beautiful pictures in magazines, and those of us who are very used to the aurora, we see what's getting published. It's often sometimes not exactly true to what we saw.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's, in some ways, it's false advertising. But at the same time, it actually, it equates to catching a trophy fish. As a photographer, that is the actual end product. I think the goal, though, is ultimately to educate about the lights are there. This is what they look like when you take a photo of them. But we also now want to communicate that when you have the experience as yourself, it's a different experience. But last night was a great example where we had multiple breakups, the aurora was going nonstop, and there were periods where there was really intense pink, vibrant pink or purple, and that's an indication that the aurora was really, really entering the atmosphere at an extreme pace, and it was reacting with nitrogen. And on some nights, we don't see that intense pink color. And on some nights we do, but everybody else has gone to bed and you're the only one who saw it. And you explain it the next day. And so really it boils down to your own personal interaction with the sky and those colors. But it's an excellent question.
Yeah, very good question. I'd like to invite Dr. Shimyo from New York. He just arrived here. And he's one of my best friends and high school classmate. And eye doctor in New York. And is it true that we are seeing things or colors by our brain, not by our eyes?
We perceive color by the brain, but the retina has at least three different photoreceptors. And about 6 to 8% of the males have deficient perception of the red spectrum. Even if you're not diagnosed as colorblind, there are different degrees of sensitivity to reddish long wave light, light colors. So there are some variations in the perception in the population. Women have less incidence of color blindness, about 25%. Mm. However, when a woman says this is the color, men should not object.
Look, I'm just happy that the women are seeing red. So you're saying the men are seeing green. So you're saying the women aren't seeing green.
Okay. Yesterday, under the same aurora, two women fighting. Oh, that becomes pink. Then this one said, no, not. It's all green. How can you explain that? Both are women.
First of all, I think that's pretty amazing you brought your own expert. For one question, I want to know who else is in the room.
Also, there is another situation. The human lens becomes more tinted as your age advances. And the lens becomes yellowish, orange, and screen out certain spectrum of colors. So there are so many factors that change the perception of colors.
What colors did you see last night?
Oh, I just arrived.
Tomorrow night. So the other factors, of course, too, is we had the moon come up late, as people had observed, so that will impact the color of the deep blue of the sky, whether it's dark, or becomes a brighter blue, which will influence the tones of the aurora. And so, in other words, eat lots of carrots. That's what the message is, so you can watch as many auroras as you can. Who else has more science questions as the young scientists in the audience? Yes, at the back.
You mentioned that it's apparently solar max this year, so I'm just wondering how the auroras actually change in the solar max years. Is there a difference in like how they're actually perceived, or even in just in Yellowknife, how it was perceived?
Yeah, that's a good question. The solar maximum is a kind of a statistical concept. Even during solar maximum, today and tomorrow and day before yesterday, all different, day-to-day change, very big. Like only 1 month ago, sunspot was exceeding 120, I guess. But yesterday, only 29. Big difference. And making average of those is, and then after a while, you draw a curve, and then that was maximum. And we cannot say that today is maximum or tomorrow is maximum. Only after finishing everything, 1-2 months ago, that was maximum. But statistically speaking, using 400 years of data, average cycle is, I think, many people say 11 years, but 10, actually, accurately speaking, 10.9 years. But last cycle was period having 13 years. So something unusual is going on right now. And again, statistically, solar maximum, aurora becomes brightest. And the number of aurora appearance becomes larger and larger. But only statistical.
Yes. You showed several photographs looking down on top of the Earth so that you could see the circle of aurora around the top of the Earth.
Yes.
All the photos I saw, the circle was shifted away from the center, so it was actually closer to the pole on one side of the circle and further away from the pole on another side of the circle.
Yeah, okay. We call auroral belt or oval, O-V-A-L, and the center of that is not at the geomagnetic pole, and shifted by 2 degrees to 5 degrees, depending on the solar activity. And we can calculate that. We can obtain that very accurately using solar wind pressure and the Earth's magnetic field. So that's true that shifted by few degrees to the night side, again by solar wind pressure.
Are you predicting a breakup for tomorrow night?
Yes. Even today. Who said that today is cloudy completely? Nobody knows yet.
You
right?
Said good tonight.
Yeah, good tonight.
Yeah.
Today's condition in the solar wind is almost same as yesterday.
We just got to get the clouds out of the way. That's the issue.
Okay.
Yeah, you can hire
a
airplane.
Yeah, if you have a hot air balloon, please speak now. Yes.
Any information around climate change and the aurora?
Yeah, that's presently a big issue in the world. As I said, 400 years ago, aurora disappeared and sunspot disappeared for 75 years from the Earth. Then temperature of the Earth decreased by 1 degree or 2 degrees. And even River of Thames in London get frozen. And we have lots of pictures of that. And that kind of cold Earth is now people talking about global warming. But it's nice to have a global, how do you say that? Cooling, yeah, is coming or not. But maybe if that sun becomes less active for 100 years, then too much cooling comes. And then nobody knows, actually, right now. And a big issue internationally. So now you can say whatever you like, because nobody knows the answer. And only I can say by my own research is that something is wrong with the sun these few years. Although that the solar, we are now entering solar maximum, but the number of sunspots is very small compared to the last one, very small, less than half. What does that mean and what makes that? We don't know, but and again, nobody knows about climate change influence by the solar activity. Yes. I know that does not satisfy the.
I once saw a purple aurora and happened to be in a pulp mill town. Does air quality of that sort sometimes cause the color or coincidence?
Which latitude were you at?
Where? So near West Vedic. 50. And you turned into purple fingers, which I'd never seen.
This tall spikes. Tall spikes of pillar? Or tall spikes of purple?
Why here? If anywhere, this is the place that I should have a little less visibility, but I'm seeing.
What were you doing just before that?
Yeah, if you see aurora through this that air, then of course this, you are sitting here so that the color of the aurora changes. If you are sitting here without this messy air, then you can see this aurora as it is. But purple color can change by sunlight, that's confirmed. But I don't know that details about that, yes.
Having seen all the lots of still photos and appreciating the aurora, last night you can't explain that to anybody else. Oh, they can look at all the pictures, but they'll never experience the dancing curtains and the moving shears and everything else too. Is there a place where we can go to and see at least a generated moving for to help us explain to other people about what a moving aurora really looks like, the breakup and so on? Is there a website we can go to, anything like that?
Well, I appreciate that question.
First of all, I should say that aurora is not moving.
Right.
Do you agree with that? Aurora is not moving, but just like a neon sign, neon sign bulb is not moving. Yeah, but looks like aurora is moving. You look at the TV, then all kinds of actions there. But the TV, each of this part of the TV tube, or brown tube, is not moving at all. What makes you feel like everything is moving is that somebody in space, in the case of aurora, God maybe, is controlling, making a TV program. And next moment, this one shine, next one moving, shining this one, so that you feel like everything.
Okay.
Yeah, but, okay.
The effect of it is a place to see the effect similar to what we saw, then, regardless of my science, it being inaccurate. How's that?
I'd be honored to take this one, Dr. Campbell.
Yeah.
How many people here have been watching the aurora on their phone? Anybody? How many people have gone to the Aurora Max website from the Canadian Space Agency? Mm-hmm. So we have a live feed aurora camera in Yellowknife. If you go to auroramax.com or the Canadian Space Agency website or astronomynorth.com, there's lots of information about the sky, but it, of course, will never capture that experience. So your question is, how can you explain to somebody what you saw?
Go to Yellowknife.
Go to Yellowknife. and then the way to show them just an idea of what you saw is the Ormax webcam. We actually have an aurora replay of every single night from September all the way through till May. And so if somebody's planning a trip, for example, and they want to know what the best month is, tell them they can go to the Canadian Space Agency website or Astronomy North, or the Northern Frontier Visitors Association, which is... what is the new domain?
Visit Yellowknife.com.
And so there are links from there, and they can see the all sky imager and very clearly see how dynamic the aurora is above Yellowknife. And comment, and this is a very important point because it kind of ties this entire discussion together, even explains why Dr. Kemmede is here. Is the aurora above Yellowknife is so common. And that is the thing. Even doesn't matter whether it's solar minimum or solar maximum, there's an aurora overhead.
Yes.
And it can be very faint, or it can be very intense. And whether there's activity on the sun or not, we have an opportunity to learn about what's going on in the upper atmosphere and what's going on in the magnetic field just by coming to Yellowknife. So you guys deserve a ton of credit for knowing that last night was going to happen. You knew it in advance. You knew Dr. Kamene would be here. And that you're all here today. We're all kind of celebrating that experience from last night together. And it is, I've tried for years to explain to people. You can't explain it. So just tell them to come. That's the best thing.
So you are the one who made the aurora last night.
It wasn't me.
Very much.
You were taking credit.
I tell everybody it was Dr. Kennedy.
Yeah.
Any more questions?
One thing that would be helpful for your website is just for some of us amateur photographers who have expensive cameras that don't know how to use them, is if you have like the doctor said 5 seconds for exposure time. If there's a couple of other things like just for us novices, you know, that own expensive cameras and don't know how to use them without autofocus, you know, just like 5 things, you know.
So all of you are about to become experts on photography. So each and every night, the aurora is different and the light conditions are different. So you have to manage a couple of things. One is your aperture. It should be as wide open as possible, or the number needs to be as low as possible, usually 2.8 or sometimes 5.6. That has to be there because it's letting in as much light as possible. Focus on infinity. And digital cameras are great because they allow you to see what mistakes you're making instantly. Zoom in on a star, make sure it's crisp. Next, try and have a wide angle lens. A zoom lens is going to narrow down the line of sight for the camera. It's going to absorb less light because of the focal length and because it's looking at a much smaller part of the sky. So a wide angle lens is very important. Number one thing, lens cap off. and a tripod. So if you don't have a tripod, put it on something, aim it up at the sky, and you're trying to take an extended exposure. But depending on the light conditions, that exposure could be 5 seconds, 10 seconds, 15 seconds, 20. So do them all and see which one appeals to your camera. Film speed is the last point, and again that depends on light conditions. But these modern cameras, the film speeds can go way up. So it used to be, film, you know, we'd say shoot at 800, 15-second or 10-second exposure, 800, and that's a very general statement. Try different film speeds. Generally, you will nowadays 1250 is a good number, 1250, 800, you can go to 400 if you want, but it becomes very dark. And the movement of the aurora can be very fast. So you want to have a bit of a faster film speed. And a lot of these new cameras are so unbelievable that you can record even the fastest moving auroras now. So last night, when I was looking at, who was the gentleman who took the photos that were on the screen earlier, Dr. Camidate? Was that you?
No, Aurora Village.
Aurora Village, okay. I'm not sure if the photographer is here. But a lot of the photos I was taking last night were at 1250 ISO, 2.8 was the aperture. Exposure length was about 6 to 8 seconds.
Thank you.
So, and
don't forget to charge your batteries.
Charge batteries. Bring spare batteries, and don't keep them on your outside pocket. Keep them in your inside pocket.
Don't let them freeze.
Yeah. And your cell phone should be on your inside pocket. Otherwise, you are going to be talking to yourself on the phone. Very important. And you can go out. This is the amazing thing about technology these days. Now you can go out, and based on if you watch the Aurora Max camera tonight, you say, okay, well, should I go out now or should I go out later? And you go on, you see an arc. You see the first arc of the evening? Go. If you don't see an arc, keep drinking that Tim Hortons. Just get warm, get ready, and plan for a 4-hour trip. Don't plan for a 10-minute trip. And go out and enjoy the show. So there, and I hope that answers. And I'll be here for the next 20 minutes.
Like a night like tonight when it's cloudy, is there any way we can drive